So today I'm going to present the work I started during my postdoc at the CEA and also at the INS Cachan under the supervision of Marc Torrent. For almost 1 year now, I'm working on a completely different project and even a different code, actually, at the IMPMC in Paris. But today I will going to talk about ab initio computation of Raman spectra within the DFPT formalisms coupled with the PAW method. So at first I will briefly introduce the theory of non-resonant Raman scattering. In the second part, I will present the implementation we have done in the Abinit package. As I already talked about this part 2 years ago at Fréjus, I will not go into much detail on that part. Then I will present the workflow needed to compute Raman intensities and show an example on for the alpha quartz phase. And at last, before concluding, I will show how we adapted the PAW plus U formalisms to in order to do Raman spectra with the plus U terms and show preliminary results on LiCOO2. So the mechanisms responsible of the Raman scattering is an inelastic scattering of an incident photon interacting with a phonon. The measured spectra, as shown here on the bottom left, are then a set of peaks, and each peak, every peak corresponds to an active phonon mode. Note that active phonon mode have null wave vectors. Every peak can be approximated as a Lorentzian function, and so depends on three parameters: its position, its intensity, and its width. The position equals exactly the phonon frequency of the mode involved in the scattering process, and can be computed from second derivatives of the energy. Second derivative of the energy with respect to two atomic displacements. The intensity, which is the subject of this work, are computing from third derivatives of the energy with respect to one atomic displacement and two electric fields. The widths are more complex to compute and involve more than other third derivatives and are not implemented yet in Abinit. The goal of my work was to adapt an already existed implementation of the intensities to PAW pseudopotentials. So, but before doing that, a preliminary work was needed, as explained here. So, from the 2n plus 1 theorem, we know that the third derivative of the energy depends only on the ground state wave functions and first derivative wave functions. They are obtained solving a first order Sternheimer equations. However, how we deal with electric fields perturbations, we have to deal with the position operator, which in the k-space is a kind of is a gradient operator, so it is itself a derivative. That way, computing scalar product like this, which contains only first order terms, in fact, second derivatives of wave functions appears. So we need to solve a second order Sternheimer equations. In the previous Abinit implementation, the gradient operator was kind of discretized, so there was no need of such second derivatives. However, the formalisms used was difficult to adapt to PW, and also it decreases the convergence with respect to the K-point grid. So we decided to implement second order Sternheimer equations in order to go further. So first and second order Sternheimer equations have similar structure, as the matrix A here is the same, only the right hand side differs. And so that was the first part of my work. Then I was once this was done and tested, I was ready to adapt the computation of third derivatives using that framework. The third derivatives for norm-conserving pseudo-potentials contains only three terms, and I had to change only the first terms to take into account second derivatives of wave functions. In the PW case, of the equations become a bit more complex. There are a lot of additional terms to compute that are shown here in red. And but the work has been done. And so to test my to validate this implementation, I've done a test on aluminium arsenide. So here I present one tensor element of the third derivatives I compute. On the lower the higher frames shows norm-conserving results. The lower frames show PW results. The blue points are the new represent the new implementation. The green one is corresponds to the previous implementation in Abinit, and red is are the results obtained by finite difference method. So, all of this with respect to the k-point grid. So we see that all the different methods converge to the same value, both in norm-conserving and PW potentials. And we see that, so here I show the convergence rate of the difference methods. So we see in the case of norm-conserving that the convergence rate of DFPT, so the new method, is faster than the old one. And in fact, so the main result of this, what I want to show here, is the difference between DFPT and finite difference method that is shown on the black line here. So I get a very good precisions. So that results validate the implementation. So, how do we compute Raman intensities in practice? So at first, of course, I use Abinit to compute the derivatives I need, so second and third order derivatives. Then I launch MergeDDB and AnaDDB to first diagonalize the dynamical matrix and get the four known modes, eigenvectors and eigenvalues. I compute the Raman tensor, noted alpha m, for every phonon mode, which is the key quantity to obtain in order to compute Raman intensities. It is basically the product of the third derivatives I've computed times the eigen displacements. Once it's done, so the Raman tensor are printed in the AnaDDB output. And I can use then a post script, a Python script, which is inside the post-processing folder in Abinit, called Raman underscore spect dot pi, which was originally written by Nicolas Pike, and I modified it in order to a little bit to get exactly what I needed. So this script can read the output of AnaDDB to produce Raman intensities, reading the Raman tensor and the phonon frequencies here, And also, so user has to specify the experimental setup as light polarization, here EI, for the incident light, so, and also for the scattered light, and also the temperature in order to fix the boson factor. This script can also, so this is the general formula for a monocrystal with polarized light, but we can also compute the intensities for a powder. Okay, so this is for TO modes. For LO modes, the workflow is a bit more complex because we have a supplementary terms in the Raman tensor for longitudinal modes. And so we have to compute other derivatives, in particular another third derivative with respect to three electric fields. So it is simply the nonlinear electric susceptibility. So it's computed using exactly the same framework than the other one. And one remark, so for ELO modes, the Raman tensor depends on the direction. This term is non-analytical because it depends on the direction one used to approach gamma. So we cannot compute, so the Raman, so the script cannot compute powder spectra for ELO mode. Just keep that in mind. We have to do the numerical integration of all possible directions numerically. So here I present results on aluminium arsenide, no, alpha quartz, sorry. The blue line here is the theoretical spectrum obtained with PAW and LDA. As we do not compute the width, it is arbitrarily fixed to 4 centimeters per centimeters. The gray dots and black dots represent experimental values, and the red line here is a fit of the of this experimental values. So. Globally, the agreement is quite good. The worst case is for this peak. The second highest peak is the biggest difference is between experimental and theoretical values is for the second highest peak. But so here for the theoretical spectra, the width is the same for every peak. While we see from the fit that the width is quite different, especially for the second peak. And taking into account this large width, we see in fact, from the fit, the intensity is the difference between the theoretical and experimental intensity is a bit reduced. Just comparing with the eye, the agreement, it's a bit better. So, at last, as we have done the work for PAW, it was not too complicated to adapt it to the PAW plus U case. So we were motivated to do it. So, in the LDA plus U formalisms, once combined the DFT with the Hubbard model that corrects the electron-electron interactions of orbital localized around the ions. So basically, we have additional terms in the expression of the energy and the Hamiltonian, which involves a matrix occupation matrix here. However, if we use the formalisms this way in the FPT, so we have to compute the derivative of all these quantities, and especially in, at the third order, it becomes quite complex. And in fact, so the, we can do much. We have a much simpler solutions following the PW. Formalisms, we define these matrices here, which are very common and used everywhere in every PW terms. And so that way we can write the plus U terms as a product of these matrices times an array that does not depend on any perturbations. It's a constant. This way, the plus U terms have exactly the same structure than the Hartree terms, than the on-site Hartree terms. So when we derived these terms, we just have to derive the products of the whole matrices exactly the same way than for the Hartree term. At last, I present preliminary results on LICO02 for plus U. So first, I check that the Raman tensor from DFPT and finite difference are the same. And I compared with a work done by Miwa in 2018, so it's quite recent. And we see, he used ultrasoft potentials and a GGA functional. And we see that when there is no plus U for both GGA and LDA, the intensity peaks are quite similar. Whereas when we use plus U, even in our case in LDA, the ratio between the two peaks decrease, which is more so, which is closer to the experimental values. So to conclude, so Raman intensities in PW are available now in the VNIT version 8.10. The plus U implementation will be released soon, and. So now all this work, a huge work has been done on the nonlinear routines, and so we can make much more benefits on it of it, implementing, for example, GGA or also computing other third-order derivatives. Thank you.